Welcome to the Orange Couch.
I'm Mark.
I'm Amanda.
And this is Mad Men, Season 7, Episode 13, The Milk and Honey Root.
We don't smoke marijuana in Muskogee. We don't take our trips on LSD. We don't burn our draft cards down on Main Street. We like living right, being free.
Mad Men continues its drift away from subtlety as it says goodbye to its loyal audience by having Don dream about Merle Haggard's classic anti-hippie broadside, Okie from Muskogee. The song sets up one of the big themes of this episode, an exploration of cosmopolitanism and urban decay versus the romanticization of provincial life, where, to quote the song, a place where even squares can have a ball.
The lost allure of the city has been driving Don West for the last several episodes, and the literature in this episode is similarly disillusioned. The Godfather is all about the seamy underbelly of New York, and The Woman of Rome tells the story of a group of city folk who are terrible to each other. Pete finally starts to feel the same way about the city. He used to long for Don's apartment. Now he's ready to give it all up.
Wichita is beautiful and wholesome. And not the city, and not Cos Cob.
But while the characters feel the allure of the simple rural life versus the big, bad city, the audience is primed from the get-go to question that dichotomy. From our 21st century seats, Okie from Muskogee doesn't feel like a harmless song celebrating Middle America. On the contrary, we recognize the song as the beginning of an ugly us-versus-them narrative that has, in our time, led to the Tea Party, abortion clinic bombings, the riots in Ferguson, and Sarah Palin squawking about real America. The cities can be decadent criminal places, but the country's claim to squeaky-clean moral superiority leaves a lot to be desired.
That's exactly what Don discovers in Alva, Oklahoma, in the end. He winds up at a country motel after his car breaks down, and before long he's trying on for size the life Dick Whitman might have led. He's pushed into handyman service and odd jobs where he's needed. He's getting blitzed and telling war stories at the American Legion. He even comes across a young version of Hustler Dick in the form of Andy. Don gets a look back at what might have been if he'd had a do-over, and he's almost charmed by it. Almost.
Don is reminded of exactly how much small towns can be just as criminal and immoral as big cities when he gets jumped by a bunch of people he was just about to consider friends, and has to get his money out of Andy, who stole from the American Legion and set Don up to take the fall, which really ties into the big overarching theme of the episode, whether you can really start over and leave your past behind. For a moment there, Don seems to think he can just hit the reset button so that New York, his career, his marriages, all that is gone and he's just Dick Whitman accepted for who he is.
But it doesn't work like that. Part of the reason everyone from Andy to the Legion are a wee bit suspicious about Don is that he comes with all the trappings of his New York millionaire lifestyle, the life he's trying to leave behind. Those sunglasses, that slick suit he wears to the Legion, and the way he throws around money all point to Don being an outsider. And sure enough, Andy paints him for a mark and the Legionnaires assume he's a crook. Generally, Don's been learning that running from reality doesn't work, but in this episode he slips back into reset mode and it ends as bad as it usually does.
In a twist that no one saw coming, the one person who seems to have actually learned that you cannot leave the past behind and that there is no starting over is Betty. Betty smoked her entire adult life and she has cancer and is going to die. But while her husband Henry is frantically and understandably clutching at the remote possibility that this can all be undone and her life can be saved, Betty, and I can't believe I'm saying this, maturely realizes that this is it and it's time to accept her life and make the best of what is happening.
This is best shown in her letter to Sally. Betty might have implored Sally to be a good girl or some other version of what Betty always wanted her to be. But instead, Betty sees what Sally is, accepts it, and even realizes it's a blessing.
Sally, I always worried about you because you marched to the beat of your own drum. But now I know that's good. I know your life will be an adventure.
She's not looking back. She's not caught up in idealizing what might have been. She's seeing the beauty of the reality of things, and that brings her peace.
But while this transition to mature Betty feels sudden to viewers, we're given a hint that she's been this way for a long time.
I have class.
Why are you doing that?
Why was I ever doing it?
Henry, Don, probably everybody thought that Betty starting school was her attempt at hitting the reset button. But she didn't see it that way. She saw it as starting a new chapter in life and finding something to do that interests her. And because of this, she sees no reason to stop just because her life is coming to its end.
Meanwhile, Pete lands somewhere in the middle. On one hand, he totally owns his past mistakes and the fruitlessness of them, both to his brother and his ex-wife. He's ready to try and be a real family man, and he's proven before that he can be a good partner when his heart's in it. But he's also being awfully idealistic about how quaint and pure Wichita's going to be, and that doesn't seem like a person moving forward realistically. Before he puts on his best salesman in the business hard sell, Trudy even calls him on it.
You know, I'm jealous of your ability to be sentimental about the past.
I suspect that Pete is one character we're never going to get real closure for. Will this move be a failed attempt to start over? Or will it be a new chapter in the life of two people who are moving forward while not forgetting the past? I think we will be left to wonder, with no real answers ever provided.
The title of the episode refers to a famous hobo handbook from the 30s, and at the end, Don is left much like the hobos he encountered as a kid, wandering with a bag under his arm and not much else. In the final episode, will Don finally stop running away and start running toward something?
We'll find out next week on The Orange Couch. And be sure to check out our weekly Game of Thrones podcast, House Slate, at slate.com.